not here to celebrate her death. We're here to celebrate her life and mourn her death. So there will be laughter and there will be tears. And I would try to stop here and cry because I understand pain and grief. But we want you to also laugh and smile. Amen.
We thank you. We give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. Because you're the true and living God. You're absolute God. You're almighty God. And we thank you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love and plan for our lives. We can do work for your Son, Jesus Christ. You may be sin for us. We do no sin. And we might be made righteous in you and him. Thank you for your mercy and grace, Father God. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your death, burial, and resurrection, that you triumphed over sin and death, and you gave us the victory, Lord Jesus, and you're at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us from the very power of sin. And Lord Jesus, you didn't leave us down here by ourselves. You sent the promise of the Father, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is asked that you comfort this family right now. Father God, as they come together as a family, as a unit, Father God, there needs no division, Father God. We thank you for peace. We thank you for your comfort, Father God. Father God, they lift the memories up. Father God, of their sister, their mother, Father God, their cousin. Father God, we just thank you right now for the peace, Father God, that only comes from you. We thank you for laughter for this day, Father God, as the eulogy goes forth, Father God, with their loved ones, Father God. We thank you. Father God, we give you all the glory that you continue to comfort all the hearts, all the broken hearts that you will mend together. Father God, that they will remember, Father God, good times, Father God, and we just thank you and give you all the glory. All and all the praise in Jesus Christ's great and mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
To the King, I don't have much to bring.
depending on how what she meant to each one of them specifically. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We bless you this morning. We lift you up this morning, Lord God. This is all about you. You knew this time would come. And you already looked ahead and made provisions. Hallelujah. And so we will glorify you in praise. We will glorify you in worship.
About such wonderful things as these. If God is for us, who can ever be against us? Verse 35, can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? That's a rhetorical question. Can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we had trouble or calamity or persecuted or hungry or destitute, or in danger, or threatened with death? No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, neither our fears for today, nor our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. Verse 39. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed nothing in all creation, will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. May the Holy Spirit comfort you all with his word. Amen.
We're about to celebrate. We're about to worship God because God is still good. I've sat in these seats, lost my loved ones. It's not easy. But God is still good. And we're going to worship him. Not for her death, but for her life. Amen.
So, Fatima, Mama's sister, asked me to say something. Johanna. I never got a chance to meet her face to face. But I've spoken with her maybe over the last 7 years. She's done my taxes, my little children's taxes. And we've had conversations outside of that. And I just wanted to say that she's, her sweet spirit and tone and her actual concern for me and my situation has been great. And when I heard that she passed, it kind of broke my heart a little bit. And even my kids. And so I just want to say she was a phenomenal woman. And she would encourage me. She knew my personal situations. And she was never judgmental. But she loved me. And I just wanted to celebrate her and honor her by being here today in worship.
Thank you.
So we invite you in, Jesus. So we invite you in, Jesus. Halfway, halfway.
sister, your kindness and your family with love. Peace to your sorrowing hearts. From Tangela and Eric, thinking of you at this time of sadness and sending heartfelt sympathy to you and your family, to the Tiemann family. And this is from the Gates family, and this is our family from Indianapolis. Our thoughts are with you. We give way to smiles, thinking of you at this sad time. Love, Gloria and Cynthia.
Where my dad?
Hallelujah. I'm going to do my best. This is probably one of the most difficult songs I've ever had to sing. But it's really my teacher. Hallelujah.
Just not the same. Johanna lived a life of joy, and she loved her family. So, think on that. Have again. That old familiar place.
Don't shed a tear. Good morning, everyone. I wanted to just share this before anyone else got up to say. This is a time of which it's not only difficult, but a blessing. And the blessing is that it's a show of love of those who not only love my sister, but love this family. I wanted to say how much I appreciate my church, my pastors, my pastor, my brother, my friend, because I don't know how this all would have come together if not for their help. And I'm talking about us being here right now. Pastor Nutt, Pastor Rose, I love you all tremendously. And I needed to say that because sometimes we don't have church homes that support us, that are there for us, that stand up and stand out for us. I'm so grateful to all of you, to all of my family, to all of my friends, and to those that will remember, as most of you will, that as in your own sorrow, it doesn't end today. Nelson, we will be going through this for a while, but we will not go alone.
That's what's up in the front. Yes, I appreciate you, sister. Amen. I just want to say as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, just before they start, I'm just feeling Nelson right now. I've been married 50 years, so I know it's
AJ.
I can only imagine. Hallelujah. Okay, it's going to be those five, and then whoever in the immediate family would like to have
prayer.
But we would talk all the time, and we would text each other, and what I appreciated
and loved about her was that she was always sweet to me. And she would always ask me how I was doing, and she had sincerity in her words and the things that she would say. And I loved how she would laugh every couple of moments in between her talking to me. So that was, I loved that she would just say a few words and she would giggle in between. So I asked the Lord what he wanted me to say to you guys, and he reminded me of my Auntie Dorothy. She was sick with cancer, and she was sick for a while, and we were believing God for a miracle. And we prayed, and we prayed, and we prayed, and it didn't happen. She died. And it was really sad. It was heart-wrenching, because it was like, God, you said in your word that you healed, and I had faith and I believed. Why didn't it work? But God is sovereign. God said, I am good no matter what. Things didn't turn out the way that you wanted them to, but he's still good. So he said, keep hoping, keep believing, keep praying, keep trusting, because I know what's best. And I'm gonna leave with these last verses, Job 8:21. He will once again fill your mouth with laughter and your lips with shouts of joy. In Psalms 30:11, you have turned my mourning into joyful dancing. You have taken away my clothes of mourning and clothed me with joy. So I pray that during this time of sorrow that he brings joy and precious memories that make you laugh like Johanna laughed all the time. I'm praying for you guys.
To everybody that ever met her, that she ever encountered. So, thank you. thought I was really sweet, but she beat me. Man, JoJo was sweet. I got some work to do. Amen. Thank you. We love y'all.
Posse with you, all right.
Hey, y'all, very difficult for me, grandson, Stefan, cousin, for support, more support. I want to start off by saying, this is one of the hardest hitting moments of my life. I can imagine a lot of people feel similar because Grandma Jo is like a big pillar. A lot of people's lives. I see her as one of my main supporters, close competition with my mama. Right there, they always encourage me and everybody around. You can do whatever you set your mind to and support and truly one of those people that listen to you and love you in an unwavering, unconditional type of way. She kind of was kind of side of like gangbanging to her. I like that. Make sure nobody messes with the family and the friends. And if she loves you, she loves everybody around you all the time. Another funny story to me, after the unfortunate events, she's very articulate and very meticulous with the Excel spreadsheets all the time, and accounting and sticky notes. And came back and I seen the laptop, all the tax clients, the top of the sticky note says, Stefan owes me money, $200. Man, come on. You're not getting no breaks. That's crazy. I wish right now I could give her that $200 right now. But and one other kind of funny story, the only time she cussed me out a little bit, it was during Domino's. She forgot I was her grandson. It was pouring my money out there. Boom, 20, mother. It's a different side than Grandma Jo. I love that one with all my heart. I just want to put it out there. It's hard for me to process this, and for a lot of people, I'm sure. But I'm just going to try to keep it in my spirit and my heart, and the good times and the lessons learned from her. Beautiful woman. She's so humble, and I want that to just carry on through the family and through everybody she touched. Thank you, amen.
Father, this gentleman,
my name is Paul Jerome Neal, and my father is Joe J.C. Neal, and Johanna is my first cousin. And when I think about all the things that I loved about Johanna, I just have a few that I'm going to mention that stand out as foremost and really important. The first one is compassion. She demonstrated compassion towards everyone all the time. Very much on target, no matter who you are. The second one is calmness. And trust me, in our family, sometimes we need a calming factor and a calming influence. And Johanna was that person. Whether it was a family reunion, whether it was keeping track of the treasury and the money, she was there. And I will always love her for that. The third thing is her class. Grace, class, dignity at all times. In addition to that, she had a sense of, and this is something we can all use, and this is something we should keep in mind, is to be kind. It seems like a simple thing, but sometimes I think we lose track of it. So what we can take from her and we can use is we can be compassionate, we can have class, we can have grace, we can have dignity, and we can just simply be kind to people. So I'm gonna miss her dearly, and we all will miss her dearly, but we're going to move ahead and keep those things in mind
And we're going to use that as we move ahead, and we're going to practice that as something we take away from my cousin, Johanna. Thank you.
I don't want to miss anyone. You okay?
The boss is here.
I had a conniption going on last night. I had called, a few days ago, I asked Pastor Vicki to have her husband call me. That's how we do it. Call her, ask your husband to call me. It's not like I can't call him, but have people around me. And I was telling him, I think I'm going to do the eulogy, and I went on and on. He said, no, Tima, you sit down. I said, okay, I'll sit down.
Take it to the food.
And then I had a dream last night that I was going around and around, and I was saying this and saying that, and he said, Tima, sit down. But what I want to share is this. There's a song, and no, I'm not going to sing it.
No.
But I am going to share the lyrics with you, because I think they're so appropriate for us right now. The song is called I Can Only Imagine. And it says, I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. And I can only imagine what my eyes would see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. When I thought about that before I continue, I thought, because I had a glimpse. God gave me a glimpse of my brother Billy greeting Johanna. Just a glimpse. I'm not talking about a vision. I'm talking a glimpse. I just saw Bill going towards her and Joe with their hands up coming towards him. Just a glimpse. And it was like that thing in your spirit that says it is well. The rest of the song says, surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence or to my knees? Will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. When that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, S-O-N. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. What will my heart feel? I know that I can only imagine, but I also know that in God's glory, there is peace of knowing of what we can imagine when we know him, when we stand before him, when we are in the place and the position of being able to share in that glory, to have that glimpse of that glory. I can only imagine. My pastor says all the time, heaven is nice this time of year, but it's not our time. So like my cousin Paul said, we're going to take those nuggets and we're going to remember the kindness and the grace that she showed us, the goodness and the mercy. As long as we have breath, we can change. It is when there is no more, do we stay the same forever? I can only imagine, but I know this. I will rejoice in that day when I am greeted the same way that God gave me the glimpse. We have been here before with my other mother. We have been here before with our mother. We have been here before with our brother, with our uncle. We have been here before with our father. We have been here before with loved ones that I have shared. We have been here before, but I can only imagine what it's going to be like when it's that time. And I pray that each and every one of you will be able to rejoice in the same. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we give you praise. We thank you that no word of God will go out and come back void or empty. We thank you that your word today will bless people, encourage people, and strengthen people. And we give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm not a long-winded preacher, so don't think I'm going to be up here an hour having y'all walk out on me. Won't happen. I met Fatima when she was a little high school student. I was her high school counselor, for those who didn't know. So I've known her a few years. I don't want to give away her age. I'm automatically old, but it's been a pleasure knowing this family. Through her, I've gotten to know everyone. I probably knew Joe the least, but my kids, they were always talking about this beautiful lady who did their taxes. I've never heard anyone just bragging and loving someone who did their taxes. I've been doing my own taxes for 50 years. But they just loved her. They tried to get me to let her do my taxes. I said, I'm going to gather all the information I got together. I might as well do it myself. But they always had me do it. But I praise God that they have these great memories of this young lady. I want to share a few scriptures because on days like this, it becomes important. The Bible is very clear. It's appointed unto human beings once to die. And after death, the judgment. So whether you like it or not, every person in this room one day will have to face death. I don't like it a bit. When my father died, I was mad at God for years. Amen. Can I get a witness? How many of y'all have been mad at God? Don't raise your hand. Because the preacher got up and he said God was picking flowers for his heavenly flower garden. I'm so mad at God. God's picking flowers and I need a daddy. But you know, when you're 11 years old, you don't understand much about life. I've lived a long time now. After death, the judgment. It's bad enough that we have to die. After that, the judgment. We're here today because a beautiful lady left this planet, but she couldn't die because no human being can die in the real sense of the word. Human beings are spirit beings. Man is a spirit. He lives in a body and he has a mind. Your body is your earth suit. You only need it while you're on the earth. If you go to space, you need a space suit. On the earth, you need an earth suit. This is my earth suit. You should have seen it when I was 20 years old. Man could tell me nothing. You know what I'm talking about. But my suit is wearing out. I got lines that didn't used to be there. My hair is gone. Oh yeah, I had a natural too. That beautiful hair. My brother, he said, Rick had such pretty hair, but I got to keep mine. So my brother's 78, he still got his hair. I'm 76 and I don't have mine. I got pains I didn't used to have. I walk slow down that aisle. I got three pins in my hip, and they just started bothering me about 6 years ago. Why? Because my house is wearing out. How much longer are you going to live, man? I don't know. But I'm going to live today, and I'm going to talk to you for a few minutes. Is that all right? None of us can stop this old house from wearing out. We can postpone it a little bit, you know, lifting weights and running, all that stuff. I did all of that. I was a basketball star. I used to dunk on people. Now, I touch the net sometimes at the bottom. The most important thing is not so much that you're going to die, because all of us share in that. The important thing is the judgment. When I was 26 years old, actually when I was 11 years old, after my father died, it hit me so hard, I gave my life to the Lord. But it didn't seem like it worked, because I was bad during my teens. All my brothers and sisters, they served God all through their teens, not me. I served myself. But at 26 years old, I gave my life to the Lord 50 years ago. And I never looked back. Never looked back. One of these days, I'm going to face God. One of these days, you're going to face God. So then, every one of us shall give an accounting of his own self unto God. I don't mind giving an account to you, because I'm probably living better than most of you. But I'm not the standard. Jesus is. So when I stand before God, I will not be able to give him my credentials. Well, I'm a pastor. Been a pastor for 44 years. I did this, I did that, I did the other. None of that will matter. Doesn't matter how well this beautiful lady did. Taxes? Not now. Now all that matters is, did she know Jesus? That's all. Did she know Jesus? Not was she perfect. Jesus already took care of that. But did she know the King? Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. It is by grace that we have been saved, through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. If I'm saved because I'm so good, I can brag about it. But the Bible says, not by works of righteousness which we've done, but by his mercy and his grace. Amen? Grace is charis in the Greek. It means the undeserved favor of God. I don't deserve it. Some of you may have known me when I was a bad actor. I understand. I acknowledge that. I was at a funeral, and all the bad guys at the funeral, they came with me. We was laughing and talking. And a lady from my church, she said, "You don't know my pastor?" I said, "We know Ricky Nutt." I said, "These my boys, they know me. We used to run the streets together." I said, "But I've been transformed by the grace and the mercy of God." You wouldn't have said I was a nice person like this young lady. I wasn't always nice. But God took my sins and he buried them. He blotted them out. As far as God's concerned, I've never done anything wrong because of Jesus. He paid the penalty for my sins. So when I stand before God, all that stuff I did in the past, it won't be there. My name has been written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and my sins have been forgiven. They've been blotted. And Johanna, as a believer in Jesus, that's what it takes. By grace, through faith. By grace, through faith. And the faith to believe is not of your own doing. It's a gift. It's a gift to believe this. Some people, they don't believe a thing I'm saying. If you believe what I'm saying, that is a gift that God has given you. That you could believe. Some people would rather believe they came from an alligator or a monkey. But I believe the Bible. Amen? And I recognize it's a gift from God to have faith to believe that this is not the end. This is not the end. This is a stopover. As a believer, Paul said in Ephesians Second Corinthians chapter 5. I'm going to read that and I'm going to be through. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. When a believer dies, the only thing we have left is their earth suit. The body is the only thing that dies. You know why you can't die? Because you were not created in the image of anything but God. God said, the horses created after their own kind. Dogs created after their own kind. Cows created after their own kind. Then he got to man. He said, let us make man in our image and likeness and give them dominion over the earth. People say, what color was God? You missed it. God don't have a physical body like you. It's not about color. It's your spirit. It's that part of you on the inside that cannot die. That's what was made in the image of God. When your dog died, they can hold and bury him. It's all over for him because he doesn't have a spirit.
Glory to God.
But when a human being dies, we grieve.
Glory to God.
They're eternal beings. You live on forever. You only get to choose where. Could die if you wanted to. Oh yeah, this body can deteriorate. But this ain't you. This ain't me. I used to like how this looked, but this ain't really me. It's just my house. Thank God for my mom and dad. They gave me a nice looking house. All this is for your benefit. So that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we're being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen, the spirit, is eternal. Wow. Did you hear that?
Yes.
Well, watch this. Of course, my phone is acting crazy. That's all right. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, call the body a tent. Anyone who's been camping, you understand that a tent is a temporary habitation. You can take it down and then put it back up. Your tent is not you. Your tent is where you stay when you're camping. Johanna was camping down here. She had a beautiful body to live in, beautiful tent. But we know that if the tent that we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands.
Come on.
Aren't you glad? This is not the end. We have another building, another house, an eternal house, an immortal house. And it's real. When Jesus rose from the dead, he walked the earth. He said, Philip. He said, Thomas, actually, Thomas. He said, handle me. A ghost doesn't have flesh and bones like you see me have. Because you remember, Thomas had said he wouldn't believe unless he saw Jesus and touched him. So he was able to touch him. He had corporality. He was real. He was not a ghost. His hand didn't go through him. You might not understand, Tony, what it means to be a spirit being on the other side when you receive your mortality, but you continue to live. You live on. another building, eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling. Because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling. So that what is mortal, the word mortal means doomed to die. This is a mortal body I live in. It's a mortal body you live in. That body's going to die. It's mortal. It's doomed to die. So that what is mortal may be swallowed up by eternal life. Now the one who has fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. That's our goal, to be home with the Lord. But right now, we are away from the Lord, but absent from the body, present with the Lord. Joy is with the Lord now. She's alive. My daddy's there. Your relatives that love Jesus, they're there. They're in his presence. And you don't get there because you're perfect. I have to say that because some people think that you got to be perfect. I'm sorry. If I was perfect, God would not have to send Jesus. He could have sent me. I could have took care of this for y'all. How many of y'all know he didn't send me? Well, why are you laughing? He didn't send you either. None of us are qualified. The Bible says there's none righteous. No, not one. All have sinned and fallen short of God's glorious ideal. None of us have measured up to God's glorious ideal but Jesus. And when you accept Jesus as your Savior and your Lord, the Father applies all that he did to your account. Took all of your sins, laid them on Jesus, and Jesus has made you righteous. Then you learn how to live. Your good works bring glory to God, but your good works don't save you. Amen? Amen. Good works are important because you want to reach other people. But I'm saved by grace plus nothing. And I'm thankful. That's why we talk about Jesus all the time, because he did for us what we couldn't do for ourselves. Let me say a word of prayer for the family. If you would just bow your hands, stretch your hands toward the family. Father God, I thank you for this beautiful family. You know their pain. You know their struggles. Let not one of them leave this earth without knowing you. Send laborers across their path with the gospel. Cause them to know Jesus before they leave this earth. So when they stand in the judgment, they'll stand as a righteous person. And we thank you for it, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. 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 In the hands of the mortician.
Yeah.
to await the resurrection of the dead. Ashes to ashes, and dust to dust.
Watch your step.